Welcome back, geology fans. When we have an information bomb, a rock, before us that seems fairly tough, dense, the crystals are tightly packed together and not lined up, and those crystals are larger than 1 millimeter diameter, then we are led to thinking we have encountered an intrusive igneous rock. The other term for this rock type is Plutonic igneous rocks, as Pluto was the Roman god of the underworld. The extrusive rocks we will meet in the next episode are also called the Volcanic Rocks, as Vulcan was the god of volcanoes. Rocks, generally, are great thermal insulators and so act like blankets, releasing their heat very slowly. And the deeper we go into the Earth, the hotter it gets in what is known as the geothermal gradient. So when magma cools and crystallizes underground, it happens so slowly at such a consistently high temperature that the atoms have time to jump into place in any existing crystal lattices, even in a high viscosity magma. The slower we cool, the larger the average crystal size and the resultant rock. So the intrusive or plutonic igneous rocks have phaneritic, which we defined as having crystals over 1 millimeter to a few centimeters, to pegmatitic texture, where the crystals are over a couple of centimeters. And I use the rule of thumb. If the crystal diameters are wider than my thumb, I call it pegmatitic. And I know it cooled very, very, very slowly. We're talking potentially millions of years here. So, if we can see the crystals easily, we can stick to this side of our igneous rock name chart, and remember that if we do have a pegmatitic texture, we just use the phaneritic name on this chart followed by pegmatite, like a granite pegmatite. We will start with the ultramafic intrusive peridotite. The name comes from the peridote olivine crystals that dominate these rocks, but the name peridote itself has clouded French origins. This is a beautiful and relatively fragile rock, with the greens of its granular olivine crystals and the black pyroxenes, and a bit of dark Ca plage crystals as well. The designation of an ultramafic chemistry is due to having less than 45% silica. So even in our ferromagnesian rocks, those rich in iron and magnesium, the silica tetrahedra is still the dominant chemical compound. Ultramafics just have the least silica of all of our magma chemistry groups. These ferromagnesian rocks tend to have their magmas originate in the silica-depleted mantle layer of the Earth, or at least from magma bodies that originated from the mantle. The ferromagnesian minerals tend to also be a little bit denser, so the rocks that they make up also tend to be a little denser than the felsic rock end. A quick note on how I will handle the rocks versus I did the minerals. I'm not going to belabor the economic uses of our rocks, as they're basically the same as the minerals that make them up, and we covered that in plenty of detail over in our mineral episodes, so I'll only note use if it's unique to the rock itself. I also want to note that there are many more names for our rocks as we get more and more detail from our information bombs. I only want to briefly mention such inflections, and we see here that peridotite can be subdivided into rocks such as dunite, lertzolite, and hartzburgite. My lumping strategy to get you the basic rock names like peridotite, without dragging you down into those other names, will try to thread the most useful path I can. When we later encounter rocks in the field and I use any name not detailed here, I will be sure to go into the specific details of that rock at that time. So moving on from peridotite, but staying in the coarse-grained, phaneritic, and pegmatitic igneous rocks, we add a bit more silica to get the mafic igneous rocks. We mentioned in the third episode of the Earth and Environmental Systems podcast that the term mafic is also known as basaltic, and the word mafic comes from the large amount of magnesium and iron in these rocks. So these rocks are still dominated by ferromagnesian minerals, but have gotten over 45% silica. In fact, mafic magma has 45 to 55% silica. These magmas also tend to be a bit richer in calcium and sodium than the following intermediate and felsic magma chemistries. And mafic magmas tend to originate in the upper mantle and lower crust of the Earth. Slow cooling of mafic magma results in our phaneritic rock, Gabbro. The name means smooth, shiny, or bald, and looking at these Gabbro hand samples, we can kind of guess why. We see very shiny and tightly packed black pyroxenes and feldspars with some olivine, which gives Gabbro a blackish-green color with distinctively reflective crystal faces. So when you find a dense, tightly packed crystalline rock with black to green minerals, think gabbro. You can see your varieties like Monzo gabbro and Foyd-bearing gabbro, but let's just not get into those details. We move next into the intermediate, or andesitic chemistry, which is a magma between 55 and 65% silica. With the intermediate chemistry, we see the mix of black amphibole and sodium plagioclase, along with a lighter colored and often white calcium plage and quartz, which give these rocks a bimodal coloring, that is, two distinct colors of ranges of white and ranges of black. Cooling slowly to a phaneritic texture allows these minerals to give the rock a salt and pepper, white and black appearance, making the mineral grains fairly easy to distinguish. And this rock is called diorite, a name which means to distinguish, though I'm not sure if it's called that because the mineral grains are easy to distinguish from each other, or this is one of the easier rocks to spot in the field and distinguish from other rocks. When I was a budding geologist learning to identify diorite, it hit me that it looked a bit like a Dalmatian dog with its black and white spots, and Dalmatian and diorite both start with D, so Dalmatian diorite, easy to distinguish. These magmas come from the lower crust, or mafic magma, from the mantle interacting with more silicic felsic crust to make an intermediate chemistry magma. Diorite's most common variants are monzonite and syenite. And we end today with a felsic chemistry, which has over 65% silica, and often averages around 72%. But the name felsic tells us there's a bit of iron and aluminum in there as well. Potassium starts to build up as well, and out of this mix we see quartz, joined by biotite and muscovite mica, and the pink to red K-spar end of the feldspar series. When coarse-grained, we call this rock granite. And the principal basement rock of the continents on which most of us live is granite. It is most easily distinguished by its pink to red colored K-spar crystals, which give felsic rocks a generally pinkish color. All the variation in color and appearance of these minerals and coarse grain rocks makes them rather easy to see from each other, and the name granite comes from granum, meaning grains, as the individual crystal grains are easily visible in granite. In the variants, we see quartz-rich granitoids, cyanogranite, monzogranite, while the granodiorite sits between our felsic and intermediate chemistries, making fun of our pigeonholed boxes. And while we are reminded that nature does not like to be pigeonholed, we look to our organizing texture versus chemistry boxes to see that we have filled the coarse-grained phaneritic and pegmatitic, peridotite, gabbro, diorite, and granite. All these rocks were delivered to us from Pluto, the underworld. For that reason, if you have encountered any of the rocks we have mentioned today, two words should spring to mind: uplift and erosion. If we know a rock forms underground, then uplift and erosion of the overburden had to take place to get it within our surficial reach. When we come back next time, we will see what the god Vulcan can make of our magma chemistries when they erupt onto the surface as lava and pyroclastic debris. Episodes 3 and 4 of the Earth and Environmental Systems podcast will help prepare you to meet the aphanitic and glassy igneous rocks when we come back next time here on Earth Explorations.